What did you do?
As anardas are being removed, as offenses are being removed, as the results of sin is being removed, as inauspicious qualities are being removed, as auspicious qualities are coming in the heart, good qualities of compassion, freedom from false ego, humility, offering respect to all without desiring any respect for others, from others. Now, beginning as a semblance on this stage of asati, and then when asati reaches its maturity, at that time, a semblance of one's spiritual form, our siddha-deha, siddha means perfect, deha means body, our real spiritual body, and real spiritual emotions begin to manifest in the heart as a semblance. Real spiritual emotions means whatever before asakti, whatever emotions we have, they're not really our emotions. Pride, envy, happiness, distress, longing, they're not really our real emotions. They're perverted reflections of our emotions. Real emotions, as the semblance begins, as the real body begins, and that's in the mature stage of asakti. So I'm going to read the verse, the fifth verse of Shikshastakam, which corresponds to that fifth stage. And then we'll read the translation of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's song that we just sang. So, Ayananda Tananja Kinkaram Patitama Visameva Vambudo Kripaya Kavapada Pankaja Sintaduri Sadrisham Vichintaya. O Nanda Nandan, O son of Nanda, as a result of my fruitive activities, I have fallen into this fearful ocean of material existence. Please bestow your mercy upon this eternal servant of yours. Consider me to be just like a speck of dust at your lotus feet, and always accept me as your purchased servant. A purchased servant has no thought at all of his own maintenance or his own activities. He knows those are all controlled by his master. Dust. Here comes the word dust. Please accept me as a speck of dust at your lotus feet. But that dust is very significant at this stage of asakti. At this stage, one is beginning to have realized knowledge of the glory of the dust of Srimati Radhika's lotus feet. And there are many prayers offered to, in worship of that dust and in glorification of that dust, as well as the glorification of the dust in Vrindavan, which carries the fragrance and the pollen and the lac, the red lac from her lotus feet. Every particle of dust of Vrindavan, because it's been walked on by her, or because it's been walked on by Krishna after he had his feet on the breast of Srimati Radhika, and the kumkum from her breast is now on Krishna's feet, and that kumkum mixes with the early morning dew that makes the grass wet and makes the grass sticky with that dust of the kumkum. Gurudev explained that every particle of dust in Vrindavan is rus. Rus means that which Krishna tastes and that which Radharani and the gopis taste in their pastimes together. That is the meaning of rus in easy language, and that rus is what the dust is composed of. The dust is also composed of the three potencies, spiritual potencies: Hladini, his pleasure potency; Samvit, Shakti, the potency by which Krishna knows himself and others know him; and Sandini Shakti, which is Krishna's existence potency, that energy that acts as the foundation for all of the pastimes. That is Krishna's paraphernalia, Krishna's dham, the houses, his jewelry. Although there are different worshipful deities of each of those potencies. Balaram is the worshipful deity of the Sandini or existence potency, Krishna of the knowledge potency, and Radharani the pleasure potency. All these three potencies are aspects of Krishna's Swarup Shakti, who, again, we come back to Srimati Radhika, who is the embodiment of Krishna's complete intrinsic internal potency, or Swarup Shakti. So this dust in this chapter, in this stage, is going to play a big part in the various verses. This stage of Asakti, just as we've been discussing from Bhajan Rahasya, that each previous stage is in the next stage, but more intensely. So whereas in the previous chapter, chapter 4, which correlates with the fourth verse of Shikshastakam, Nadanam Najanamanasandarim Kavitama Vajagati Shakamani, I don't want any wealth, I don't want any enjoyment activities or relationships or paraphernalia. I only want your service birth after birth. So in that mood, the devotee is lamenting his worthless condition and increasing his faith that if I just have ohetaki or causeless bhakti, that I don't need anything else because everything else is included within that. And that humility is there in the third verse, Trinadapi Sunichana. More humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree, offering all respects to others and not desiring any for myself. But here, in this fifth verse, fifth stage, the devotee is filled with extreme humility and lamentation of his worthless, what he considers his worthless situation. As he's coming closer to praying, his humility is increasing. As we discussed the other day, praying and humility are synonymous. Before this stage of Asakti, all the prayers of the devotee, except when he's praying to his Gurudev, are accepted by the Supersoul. At the stage of Asakti, Krishna's heart melts with compassion, and he's personally listening to the devotee's prayers. So how is it that Gurudev tells us to pray to Rupa Goswami, or that before I read any book, I put the book on my heart and head and say, "Oh Prabhu, you are not a book. You are Rupa Goswami yourself, or you are Bhaktivinoda Thakur yourself. You are Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Radha and Krishna and your associates yourself. Please shower your mercy on me." Is that a contradiction? Is only super soul listening when we pray? Was Gurudev only joking when he said, in the absence of physical sadhu sangha, you can make Sanatana Goswami and Rupa Goswami your shiksha gurus by praying as you're reading their books? By the mercy of Gurudev, we remember our Gurudev who instructed us to pray to these other personalities, and taking him with us, he requests them to hear us. But really, he's the only one who listens to us no matter how many anarthas and contaminations we have. So Guru and Guru Nista is the most important part of our bhakti. At this stage of asakti, the diseases of the heart, beginning with lust, anger, greed, pride, illusion, and envy, they are coming to be removed. The inclination to associate with materialists due to now coming to realizations as he's hearing Harikatha and Shrestha Sadhu Sangha, his inclination to have the association with materialists, mayavadis, and those attracted to the opposite sex for immoral association, that is also removed. The taste for sense objects is also removed, ever increasingly in each stage. And the devotee realizes more now how everything that's happening to him is Krishna's mercy. And even when there's suffering, he takes the opportunity to increase his offering, increase his enthusiasm for service by his body, mind, and words. And in that regard, text 3, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes the verse. As you know now, all the verses in Bhajan Rahasya are selected by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur from various scriptures and prayers to make his points. And then he gives his own corollary verses in Bengali. And then Srila Gurudev gives his own commentary. Then, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, did I quote that verse, Tateya Kampam, already? Or did I just say I was going to? So, Tateya Kampam, Sushumishamaram, Punjana Eva Makritam Vipakam, Vipakapurvirvidadamaste, Jive Tujo Mukti Pade Sadayava. Whatever suffering he's experiencing, he takes as the mercy of the Lord to disconnect him from matter. And he thus doesn't see the difference between suffering and enjoyment. He takes any trouble that he's undergoing as his greatest wealth, because it's an opportunity for him to increase his enthusiasm and service by body, mind, and words. When Srila Gurudev was lecturing on that verse in France in 1999, he noticed that the devotees were taking notes, making flower garlands, or being distracted in various ways. So he said, I want your full attention. I'm only here for 5 or 6 days, and 3 or 4 days have already passed. I want your eyes to be wide open, your ears to be wide open, and your eyes to be wide open, and your mouth to be wide open. Why? Because when Vyasadeva's wife was listening to him recite Srimad Bhagavatam, her eyes, ears, and mouth was wide open. And what was the result? Sukha, the parrot, flew into her mouth and went into her womb. So Gurudev said, if you hear like that, then transcendental knowledge will come in your heart. And we see that this stage is Vidyavadujivanam.
I'm sorry?
I've never heard that the mouth should be open.
Yeah, that was in that lecture in France.
Are you sure?
I'm positive. We sent it out on the Hare Kata. 100%. 110%. It's like, wow, as you hear it.
That is full attention. This is amazing.
So, what's the beat?
Maharaj, can you...
We will open our mouths.
It's not necessary when I speak, but when a pure devotee speaks, automatically become amazed. Wow, I never heard that. Can you explain why Vidya is compared with a vadu, or a wife?
Vidya is there already.
Huh?
It's already there.
It's there in a previous chapter, in chapter 1. But I didn't quite get it clearly. Can you explain what Gurudev said? Vidya vadu jivanam. This is the verse that correlates with this fifth stage of bhakti.
What is there?
I don't remember because it's in a previous... I'll tell you tomorrow.
Okay.
I'll look it up and tell you tomorrow.
As you really explains that real topmost knowledge is that knowledge that we have that type of relationship with Sri Krishna, which is like a newly wedded bride, which is compared to Srimati Radhika herself. With your Bhadu Jivanam, the topmost knowledge, which is there, is that the Hare Krishna Mahamantra produces that loving mood within the heart of a parakriya, or lover and beloved.
The wife is very anxious to serve and please her husband, the newly wedded wife. So like in that.
The topmost knowledge is how to serve and please Krishna. This is the topmost knowledge. And Radhika is expert in this.
So it says that the Hare Krishna mantra is Vidyavadu Jivanam. That's what I didn't understand. How Hare Krishna is compared to the beloved or the wife.
Because that knowledge which is produced by chanting the Maha Mantra is that transcendental mood of topmost service which is embodied by Srimati Radharani.
So it's contained within the mantra. So in this stage, the desire to serve and the realization that I am the eternal maidservant of Srimati Radhika is beginning to be perceived in the heart. And in text 10, starting from about text 10, and throughout the rest of the chapter, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is quoting verses from Raghunath Das Goswami, from Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur in his Radharasa Suraniti, Raghunath Das Goswami in his Sankalpa, Swasankalpa Prakash Stotra, where he's praying, where they are praying for service to Srimati Radhika. And also the explaining verses that explain the significance, importance of that service. the benefits of that service. So one verse is quoting from Raghunath Das Goswami. Why to become a servant of Radharani? How can a person become immersed in the ocean of ecstatic mellows of Sham? Kutak Shama Sindhu Rasasavagaha. What is Shama Sindhu? The ocean of Shama Ras. The meaning is Unat Odvalarasam Swabhakti Sriyam. The meaning is serving in Ujjula Ras, serving in Madhurya Ras, Parakiya Ras, as a maidservant to Srimati Radhika, and tasting her moods of her service and assisting in the development of her moods by arranging her meetings, reminding her of her pastimes with Krishna. So how can a person become immersed in the ocean of ecstatic mellows of Sham, Shama Rasa Sindhu, if he has never worshipped the dust of Radha's lotus feet, if he has never taken shelter in pastime places in Sri Vrindavan, which is marked with the impressions of her lotus feet, and if he has never served the devotees whose hearts are already merged, immersed in her profound sentiments. When Gurudev was giving samadhi to our Srila Prabhupada, he was telling the devotees, not when he was giving samadhi, but when he was explaining how he gave Prabhupada samadhi. He said that, what is the meaning of samadhi? Samadhi, the same mood, sentiments, intelligence, position as one's worshipful deity. So the pure devotees who are entering samadhi, they're already in samadhi, but they perform the pastime at the time of quitting their external transcendental form to enter into that place where their worshipful deity, Rupa Manjari, is serving their worshipful deity, Srimati Radhika, and they share the sentiments. Gurudev gives an example. I was sitting in his room with my god sister Aditya, and Gurudev said, I'm talking with you, he was telling me, and we're laughing together. And Aditya is not part of the conversation, but she's hearing, and she starts laughing too. So vicariously, she's experiencing what we're experiencing. Or if a person goes to a movie, and in the movie, somebody's husband dies, and the lady starts crying. So the viewers of the movie, they also start crying. They start identifying with that person. So this is Manjari. The sentiments of Radharani come in their hearts, and what her body experiences also comes on their body. In the morning when they first awaken, they simply have to look at themselves to know what was going on with Radha and Krishna during the night. So if one has never served those devotees who are immersed in her profound sentiments. Actually, Sripad Madhav Maharaj told me something a few years ago that he'd heard from Srila Gurudev, which was quite amazing. The first verse of Vilap Kusmanjali, which Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes here in Bhajan Rahasya as one of the prayers for service of the dust of Radharani's lotus feet. In that prayer, Raghunath Das Goswami, as Rati Manjari, is embracing and being embraced by Rupa Manjari, in his internal meditation, which again begins as a semblance in asakti. But Raghunath Das Goswami was in the, he was in prema bhakti, but he was playing the role of a mature bhava bhakta who's fully realized his soul within and has experienced his soul engaged in Radharani service. So Rati Manjari is on his way to look for Rupa Manjari, and Rupa Manjari had just been watching through the lattice creepers, had been watching, looking into the kunja and seeing some pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And then Rupa Manjari is thinking, I have to show this pastime to Rati Manjari so that her eyes can be successful. And then Gurudev said, this is the duty of Guru. It begins here in this world and then is there in its ultimate limit in that world. So they're both looking for each other, and then they both find each other midpoint, and they embrace. And Rati Manjari says, oh, I'm noticing that you have some mark on your lips which look just like a sweet bimba fruit. Did you ever see a bimba fruit? It's like so red, red-orange, and so like deep red and juicy. It's like a tomato but multiplied in beauty and sweetness and softness by millions of times. So your lips, which are just like red bimba fruits, I see that there's some strange mark on them, like a bite. And which is pretty surprising because your husband's been away for a few days buying cows. So is it that some big parrot has come and bit your lips? So of course that parrot is Krishna. And Gurudev said that there'll be no confusion in the understanding of this verse if we understand that as Rupa Manjari was looking in the lattice, in between the lattice creepers, and seeing the pastimes of Radha and Krishna, then the same mark that Radharani got on her lip came onto the lip of Rupa Manjari. And so Rupa Manjari said, yes. She smiled and tears were falling from her eyes as she embraced Rati Manjari. And she said, yes, the big parrot has bitten it. Yes, it was Krishna, but not directly. So then Madhav Maharaj told me that Gurudev said that that same mark, which is pretty amazing, the same mark that was on Rupa Manjari is also on Rati Manjari. And yet she's saying to Rupa Manjari, it's strange that you have that mark on you.
Rati Manjari wants to hide his own thing, so she's telling to Rupa Manjari.
Like Krishna wanted to hide his own thing in the beginning of Bhakti Rasayana. So he said, so he was glorifying Balaram and saying, look how all these, the branches of the trees are all dipped down to the floor, weighted down by their fruits and flowers as they're offering obeisances to you as you pass by. He was hiding his own thing. So, if somebody has never worshipped the dust of the lotus feet of Srimati Radhika and prayers for that worship and prayers to enter into that service are described here by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Somebody has never worshipped the dust of Radharani's feet, has never taken shelter of Sri Vrindavan Dham, which bears her footprints, or has never served the devotees whose hearts are already submerged in her profound sentiments through that service, how will they ever be able to dive into the ocean, the Sindhu, the Shama Rasa Sindhu? They'll never be able to come to that thing which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to give. Then, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in the next verse, quoting the glories of Srimati Radhika? Or is this rather in Vritti? This is in the commentary. Same verse, commentary by Srila Gurudev. He's quoting some of Srimati Radhika's glories. That is, when Krishna left the Rasa dance with Srimati Radhika and left all the other billions of gopis, the gopis who were searching for Krishna, seeing that there were two steps of footprints, two imprints of feet marks, realized that most certainly the Lord has been worshipped by this particular lady, because Krishna has left all of us to be with her in this solitary place. Not she's worshipped Krishna, because they don't see Krishna as God, but Govinda has left us to be with her because she's worshipped God. So, Srila Gurudev quotes, I think it's, Prem Bhakti Chandrika by Srila Narottam Das Thakur. Prayer for giving up. It's not that we can maintain our bodily conception of life and at the same time properly worship the dust of Radharani's lotus feet. Therefore, Srila Narottam Das, and therefore the Ajata Rati Sadak, throughout all these stages, as we've been discussing in the last 5 days, from Shraddha to Anartanavritti, which happens in the course of Bhajana Kriya, engaging in the limbs of Bhakti and Sadhu Sangha, one comes gradually to Nistha, then to Ruchi, and now the Ajata Rati Sadak, the Sadak who has not yet attained Bhav. Now he's coming to the stage of Bhav, he's in Asakti, where he's experiencing realization that he's not this body. So here, Gurudev feels it appropriate to quote Srila Narottam Das Thakur's prayers from Prem Bhakti Chandrika. After giving up the false identification of this material body, may I obtain the body of a gopi and reside in Vraj by the mercy of Krishna. What mercy do we want from Krishna? Shama Sundara Sakanta Sekar. I'm not asking to serve you. I'm asking that you give me the service of your dearly beloved Srimati Radhika, birth after birth. And that kind of prayer pleases Krishna the most and makes Krishna inclined to give his mercy. If Krishna sees that someone wants to serve the dust of Radharani's feet, Gurudev said, Krishna gives himself wholly to that devotee, and Krishna runs after that devotee. Becoming a maidservant of Sri Radha, I will always serve and attend Radha and Krishna, who enjoy pastimes in Paramour Ras. Narottam Das Thakur also prays, when will I go to Braj and do the service? There's extreme humility. I want to do the service of a nupur, of a ankle bell of Srimati Radhika, and tinkle and jingle as she's walking. When will I give up my male abhiman? And we ladies also have that male abhiman, that I am Purush, I am the enjoyer. So then, in his commentary, Srila Gurudev quotes the verse that he very often quotes from Raghunath Das Goswami about the glory of the speciality and glory of the maidservants of Srimati Radhika, despite the fact that they're lower in rank than the pre-unarmed sakis, like Lalita, Vishakha, and others, who have a direct relationship with Krishna. Tambula pana para marana paya dama visara divi vrindaranya maheswarim priyataya yasto shayanti priya prana prasta sakhi kulada pikila sankochita bhumikai keli bhumi surupa mandri makas tatasika swamshayeham. So when I mentioned the other day that it's very difficult to run through a course on Sri Bhajan Rahasya because it's actually a meditation book. And practically every verse is a prayer that can be meditated upon, some while chanting and all while not chanting. But these verses that are mentioned in chapter 5 can all be meditated upon while chanting. In the beginning, the guru will tell the disciple, as Prabhupada told me in 1969, when I asked what I should think about while chanting, should I try to think about the form? Should I try to think about the pastimes? Prabhupada wrote me in reply, just listen to the name. Don't worry about anything else, and gradually everything else will be revealed. And then later, we learn that I meditate on prayers, on pastimes, while chanting. Not anything that I've made up, but on what I've heard from Hari Guru and Vaishnavas. So, in this particular prayer, which is important to meditate while I'm chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, Srila Raghunath Das Goswami is praying, I take shelter of the maidservants of Srimati Radhika, of whom Rupa Manjari is prominent. Unlike the prime prastha sakis, like Lalita and Vishakha, these manjaris can perform any service at any time in the middle of any intimate pastimes of Radha and Krishna. You'll notice in the 5 Sevakunj paintings that the manjaris are standing by the door of the kunj. And generally these are very early morning pastimes that's going on in the 4 paintings of the manjaris. And then, if Lalita or Vishakha, one of the main powerful gopis, wants to enter the kunj at that time, they have to ask Rupa Manjari or another manjari who's standing by the door, is it okay if I come in? And they will check inside, yes, it's okay for you to come in now. So unlike the prastha sakis, who are equal, on an equal level to Radharani, in the sense that they also enjoy amorous pastimes with Krishna, and they are also yutesris, controllers and heads of multi-hundreds of millions of gopis, group leaders. Unlike them, the maidservants can perform any service at any time without any hesitation. Because Srimati Radhika thinks, they are my own body. I have nothing to hide from them, whereas I may have something to hide from Lalita or Vishakha, because they may want to take part of that love. Not really, but in the pastimes. But in the pastimes, the maidservants will never, even if Radharani is trying to encourage Krishna to enjoy with the manjaris, or encourage the manjaris to enjoy with Krishna, they'll never agree. So thus she considers them her own body, and they can serve in any condition, such as offering her tambul, massaging her feet, bringing her water, and arranging, helping her go out for her meetings with Krishna. I once asked Gurudev in 1996, how can I become free from fear? And Gurudev quoted this verse of all verses, to become free from all fear. He said, the maidservants are offering tambul. So they give tambul to Radharani, and then Krishna's sitting behind Radharani, and she's giving him tambul like this. And he's behind her, like that, talking about mouth being open. In other words, even though she's offering him the tambul, he's in a subordinate role to her. So Gurudev's point was, if you take shelter of Radharani, you become free from all fear. Even she gives the potency, she is the potency, her expansion is the potency of Lord Nrisingadev, who we pray to become free from all fear. Krishna's name is feared by fear personified. But only because of Radharani's is the power. So then, each successive verse, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is quoting verses about aspiring to become Radharani's maidservant. Now in text 14, he's quoting, and he does this several times in this chapter, quoting from Prabodhananda Saraswati's Radha Rasa Sudoniti. Keeping at my heart my highest aspiration of one day becoming a maidservant of Sri Radha's lotus feet, I will constantly meditate on Sri Krishna, whose head is decorated with a peacock feather. So that's the purpose then. Shamasundara Sakanda Sekar. O Shamasundara, beautiful Shyam, Sikandha Sekar, who has the peacock feather decorations on your head, on your turban, on your crown. So here again, I meditate on Krishna with that aspiration that by His mercy He'll give me the service, beloved. Similarly, in the eighth verse of Manushiksha, Raghunath Das Goswami prays, O mind, please meditate on Gokula Chandra Krishna so that he will take away my wickedness, so he will inspire me with prema, and so he will give me the service of Srimati Radhika. I will constantly chant his name, eternally serve his lotus feet, and utter his most excellent mantras. May he bestow mercy upon me at any moment so that I will attain the great festival of attachment to Sri Radha. Again and again, more quotes from Radha Rasa Sudoniti. Birth after birth, may I attain the position of being a maidservant of the daughter of King Vrishabhanan. She is the personification of playful pastimes of Shamasundara. At this stage, the Ajata Rati Sadak, who's almost at the stage of Bhav, he engages in the ninefold limbs of bhakti. Some verses back, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes Prahlad Maharaj's expression of the nine types of bhakti, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, meaning always hearing the Lord's names and pastimes, chanting them, remembering them, serving his lotus feet, going on parikrama, doing archan, worship, becoming a friend, offering prayers, becoming a friend and surrendering my whole heart, which is a very advanced stage of bhakti. So these nine limbs of bhakti are also performed at the stage of asakti, when the devotee is getting reflections of his siddha-deha, his own soul in his manjari form or her manjari form, doing services to Srimati Radhika. And in that, he's always remembering those particular types of the ninefold processes. That is, he's hearing. What is he hearing? Radharani is on her way to cook for Krishna with her sakis. And Lalita says, uh-oh, there's Shyam along with his friends and his cows. Let's not go by that pathway. He's going to definitely do some mischief. Let's go another way. And then Radharani says, why? He may be the son of a king, but I'm the daughter of a king. What could he possibly do to me? Let's continue on this path. So Krishna certainly has some mischief up his sleeve. He takes the cow's udder and squirts it right at Radharani's face. And she gets milk all over her face. And everybody's laughing except for her. So hearing is there. And meditating. Srila Raghunath Das Goswami ends his Manushiksha by saying, if you want to be always engaged in the service of Radha and Krishna along with their friends, then always engaged in drinking the Panchamrita, that is the fivefold method of service given by Rupa Goswami. Always hear about them, always meditate on them, but meditate on what? The meditation starts changing. The archan starts changing. Archan is one of the nine limbs of bhakti, but it begins to change then. For example, when the devotee is doing offering the lamp, the devotee is thinking in the afternoon that Mother Yasoda is offering a lamp when Krishna comes back from cowherding. Why? Because she wants to see if there's any scratches on his face, so then she can take her cloth, the napkin, and the concha with the water. She can take her cloth, the end of her veil, and wipe off those scratches and say, those boys, they're so naughty. I told them not to wrestle with Krishna and play so roughly, because now the minerals from the branches are now marked on Krishna's face. So the mood starts changing then at this stage. So birth after birth, may I attain this position of being a maidservant of the daughter of King Vrishabhanu. She is the personification of playful pastimes of Shyamasundara, who was himself the essence of limitless rus. She is the wonderful pleasure Lakshmi, and she is most difficult to attain for Brahma and others. Yo Brahma Rudra Sukhanarada Bhishmamukhyai. Those great personalities can barely meditate on the lotus feet of Krishna in their heart. Yet that same Krishna faints by the sidelong glance of Srimati Radhika. So therefore, may I have her service as a maidservant. Then he goes on, more verses, more pastimes. He's discussing how Jatila forbids Radharani to go out one morning after breakfast. And so she stays at home, and when Krishna finds out that she's forced to stay at her home and he doesn't get her darshan, then Krishna faints. May I have the service of that Srimati Radhika. Now in these next couple of verses, Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur decides to quote from Raghunath Das Goswami's Vilapakusmanjali. Because you remember at this stage of Asakti, The devotee is experiencing extreme humility. He already had humility in previous verses, in previous stages, in previous chapters. But now it's to the extreme humility and lamentation. So here's the perfect verse for that. Devi dukha kula sagaro dare duhyamana mati durgatam janam tvam kripa prabalano gaya dutam prapaya sva parapanka jayam. O Devi, Sri Radhika, I am in a helpless condition, drowning in the ocean of unhappiness. Please lift me upon the strong boat of your mercy and give me the shelter of your lotus feet. That is, if somebody's drowning in an ocean, the only shelter is a boat, is in the middle of the ocean. So what is that boat? It's the dust of Srimati Radhika's lotus feet for her service. Krishna also takes shelter of her lotus feet in that prayer, Smaragarala Kandana Mama Shishila Shimandanam. I'm burning up in a fire of separation from you. Please be merciful to me. Please be magnanimous and place your lotus feet on my head. So that dust is even desired by Krishna. So to please Krishna, to follow Krishna, this is the pinnacle of devotion. Then again, in Gurudev's commentary to Bhaktivinoda Thakur's verse, again, Vallabh Kusumanjali, where Raghunath Das Goswami is praying, my only aspiration is to serve your lotus feet. I will have no other desire. I offer my obeisances and place upon my head the position of your sakhi, like Lalita and Vishakha. I'll worship that. But what I really want to experience the nectar of is not that, but the service of your lotus feet. So here, in his commentary, Srila Gurudev quotes that very first verse of Vallabh Kusumanjali, where Rati Manjari is telling, there's no guru there in that realm. There's guru here, but there is friend. Although there's Anugatya, like Rati Manjari is in the Anugatya of Rupa Manjari. Rupa Manjari wants to share her mercy with Rati Manjari, and so she came to get her to witness what's inside the kunj. But still there's no Diksha Guru there. There's Shiksha Guru, in the sense that Lalita is Shiksha Guru, Vishakha is Shiksha Guru, and they train the others. Or Manjulali brings Narottam Das Thakur praise to his Gurudev, Lokanath Goswami, in his Manjari form, as Manjulali Manjari. When will Manjulali bring me to the feet of Rupa Manjari, who will bring me to the feet of Lalita and Vishakha and Srimati Radhika? And then Srimati Radhika will give me to the feet of Rupa Manjari and say, train this new sakhi in all the arts, make her expert. So, as a commentary to that verse, that I only want to be your maidservant, I don't want the position of a sakhi, Gurudev quotes this first verse of Vallabh Kusumanjali. And then, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is quoting, his next verse that he's quoting is from Stavamala of Rupa Goswami. In great extreme humility and lamentation, which we cannot imagine now because we're in the what do you call that? In the forest fire. What is that? First, the beginning of Chaitanya, Bhava Mahadavagni, where, as Gurudev said, in the Bhava Mahadavagni now, in the great forest fire of material existence, he said, even more than that, you're in an ocean fire. And when the fire comes to swallow you, the heat is so excruciating that you faint, and you're not even aware anymore how you're burning. So we're burning so much by Maya, by the influence of Maya, being eaten alive by the crocodiles and alligators of lust, anger, greed, pride, illusion, and envy. Having our hands chained behind our backs by the chains of wicked desires, that we haven't got the foggiest idea what real lamentation and humility, at least maybe you do, but I can't even imagine. So here in great humility and lamentation, Gurudev said this is one of our most important sadhana verses, verses for sadhana. A devika kubaragad kariya jivacha yache nipachya bhuvidandavada uvadarti asya purushana buddhasya janasya kritva kandarvike nijagane kananam videvi. O Devi. Devi means the playground of Krishna's sporting. O Devi, Queen Gandharika, today, in utter desperation, I throw myself on the ground like a stick. Filled with great distress, I implore you with a choked voice to be merciful to this fool and count me as one of your own. Dasi of Dasi of Dasi of Dasi. Actually, I never understood this statement of Srila Prabhupada until I met Srila Gurudev. He was quoting the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu when he's saying, I'm not a Brahmana, I'm not a Kshatriya, I'm not a Vaishya, I'm Gopi Bhartu Padakamalio, Dasa Dasanu Dasa. I'm the servant of the servant of the servant of Krishna, who's the servant of the gopis. So Prabhupada said, when you consider yourself a servant 100 times down, that is your perfection. So it's after learning this verse from Gurudev that I could understand, please put me on your list of maidservants as the servant of the servant of the servant. Put me at the bottom of your list, no problem, but put me on your list. So this is perfection. Count me as one of your own. Now it's 5 after 12. So, as we know, what correlates with the particular pair of Hare Krishna names, what correlates with the phrase in the first verse of Shikshastakam, which correlates with the chapter of Sri Bhajana Rahasya, which correlates with the stage of Bhakti, which correlates with the verse of Shikshastakam, correlates with the time of the day of Radha and Krishna's pastime. So, as I mentioned yesterday, during the Kartik month in Chandigarh, when Srila Bharati Maharaj is there, they sing the various Shikshastakam songs of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur during the course of the day, because each time of day corresponds with the time of day of Radha and Krishna's pastimes. So then, say, if it's after Maharaj's class at night, then he would read the Sanskrit of Radha and Krishna's pastime of that time in the evening. And then the devotees would sing the Bengali verse, usually in the same tune that Narottam Prabhu sang this morning of Anadi Karma Phale, In that tune, they would sing Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Bengali version of the Sanskrit of Radha and Krishna's pastime at that time of day. And then they would sing the Shikshastakam prayer as well. So here, at this time of day, now it's late afternoon pastimes, like from 3 to 6. In the afternoon, after Madhyana Leela, Sri Radha goes to her home, bathes, and gets dressed and decorated. On the affectionate order of Mother Yasoda, she prepares different kinds of preparations, like Kharpur Keli. What's that, Maharaj?
One type of cake.
Cake.
But not like in oven. They fry it.
Uh-huh. What's it made of?
Chapati flour, some other thing.
And Amritakeli, what's that?
I have read somewhere how the preparation.
Amrit?
Amritakeli. And Kharpur Keli. Kharpur is...
Krishna likes so much.
Has camphor in it.
Pitha panna.
Huh?
Pitha panna. Come say pitha panna.
What's that?
Kakira Bhutu likes so much.
Oh.
Kakira Bhutu.
Maharaj knows what it is.
Kakira. Have to go Bengal fishing then can get.
So she prepares so many different kinds of foodstuffs for Krishna. As he returns to Braj from the forest with the cows and suckers, she has darshan of his lotus face and becomes filled with delight. Sometimes Radha and Krishna may look at each other like she'd be hiding behind a bush, and the both of them would faint from where they are. Krishna also becomes fully satisfied by receiving her darshan. After meeting with Sri Nanda and other elderly gopas, he's bathed and dressed by the elderly gopis. I contemplate on this Radha and Krishna. So then, in his own commentary, Srila Gurudev tells more pastimes. During the Madhyana Leela, just before Krishna goes home, Radha and Krishna are engaging in water sports, in playing dice, in swinging, laughing, joking, and now that's completed and Krishna's going home to Mother Yasoda. This is when Mother Yasoda does the arati, and the devotee in Baba Bhakti is actually there and he's watching that arati and he's serving Srimati Radhika as she's also doing arati to Krishna with sidelong glances. And Krishna is accepting that arati more than the arati of his mother. So then she's not able to feed Krishna, like she goes there personally in the morning to cook breakfast and be in the kitchen. But in the evening she doesn't go. So let's see. In the house of Nanda, Radharani is not able to feed Krishna with her own hands, but at midday, her desire to serve in this way is fulfilled. Sometimes she makes pastries and cakes that look like trees and fruits, but they're actually cakes. Trees and fruits. This is in either Govinda Lilamrita or Krishna Bhavanamrita.
Trees?
No, they just look like that, but they're cakes.
But not big trees.
No.
No, it's cake.
Little baby trees. Or little baby fruits, but they're really cakes. He separates. Wait. Krishna goes to the forest and with his sakas to herd the cows. And on the pretext of beholding the beauty of the forest, he separates himself from the sakas to go to Swamini. Text 20 describes Krishna's condition when he sees her charmingly attractive lotus face. After Madhyana Leela, Radha and her sakis return to her home Vrindavan, and he returns with his calves and cows from the forest. In her home, she's busily performing various activities with a restless mind, eagerly desiring to meet with Krishna. Then at the time of Krishna's return,
can you read?
In her home, Sri Swamini busily performs various activities with a restless mind, eagerly desiring to meet with her Priyatama. At the time of Sri Krishna's return, the Sakhas accompanying him play their horns and other instruments, making a tumultuous sound. The Vrajavasis become extremely blissful when they see the dust flying from the cow's hooves. The arrival of Sri Krishna is like the arrival of the rainy season. The sky is filled with clouds of dust raised by the cows. The song of the flute is like a shower of nectar raining from the sky. And the cow's mooing is like the rumbling of clouds. Like extremely thirsty Jataka birds who only drink rainwater as it falls, the Rajvasis come forward. When the cowherd boys leave to go cowherding, Krishna walks in the front, and when they return, Baladev Prabhu is at the front. When Sri Krishna passes through Javadgram, Sri Radha has darshan of him through the openings in the small latticed windows of her house. Sri Krishna also craves the darshan of his beloved and sometimes receives it directly when he begs something from her. Before Priyaji can give him anything though, he steals her heart like a snatching thief. But my Swamini is no less. She also steals the heart of her Priyatama. Now each acts with the heart and mind of the other. Jiva Goswami Pad in his Sri Yugalashtakam 6 prays, Krishna Chitta Stita Radha, Radha Chitta Stito Hari, Jivana Marane Nityam, Radha Krishna Gati Anama. Radha is always firmly situated within the mind of Krishna, and Krishna is always firmly situated within the mind of Radha. May Radha and Krishna be my shelter in life or death. My desired object is the service of this divine couple. Sri Krishna arrives at his home, the house of Nanda. With the end of her sari, Yashoda cleans her Lala's face, which is covered with dust from the cows, performs arti, and then, placing him on her lap, breastfeeds him. After some time, Krishna goes to milk the cows. Upon his return, Yashoda bathes him and very lovingly feeds him the sweets sent by Sri Radha. Sri Radha's kinkaris have darshan of all these pastimes, and returning to their Swamini, who is restless and agitated, relate all these events to her. He who chants Harinam while contemplating these pastimes will, by Sri Swamini's grace, become eligible to one day serve these pastimes. Thus ends the Panchama Yama Sadhana Apurana Kaliya Bhajan of Sri Bhajana Rahas.
Thank you. This is so high, we can see why we needed to begin at the beginning of Sri Bhajan Rahasya and go through all the different stages to come here, even to read it, just because realize it. So I'll ask if there's any questions or comments, ifs, ands, or buts, additions or subtractions.
Did you say now, earlier that in the stage of Ruchi, you have to still apply your intelligence to the process? But Ruchi means taste, so you have taste. So So actually, why do you need to get intelligence? Or then, you know, before you have no taste, you have understood, this is the process, I'm a servant of Krishna, so I should do it, it's good for me. But now, in Ruchi, I thought there was taste. We don't need it.
Yeah, actually I was thinking of the same thing yesterday and the day before, and I was hoping that Sri Pad Madhu Maharaj could give an answer to that.
It is mentioned that Nishtha Buddhi Purivika Ruchi Sahabiki. So when Nishtha we have to use our own intelligence, but Ruchi still we have to use all this natural, but still in beginning have to use our intelligence. When Ruchi will mature, then it will be natural. At that time, no need intelligence. But in the beginning, will be intelligent, must be there.
So when Ruchi comes to maturity,
yeah,
means it's going into a sattva.
Yeah.
There are two kinds of Ruchi.
Mm-hmm.
There's
overlapping.
Yeah. But still, this question is there.
In the beginning, Buddhi have to use intelligence.
Even when there's taste.
Yeah.
Why?
Because Ruchi two types.
Oh, it depends on two types of Ruchi.
Yeah.
In the beginning it depends on the quality,
yeah,
of the object of worship.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm singing, you don't walk out of the room if I'm leading the singing. And if Madhukar, you hear from a mile away, you'll go there and listen. So, it depends on my intelligence mixes with my taste.
Yeah.
Also Gurudev telling these two stages are overlapping because they're next to each other.
Yeah.
So sometimes we have little Ruchi, sometimes we have to again, by strong Nishtha continue and then more Ruchi coming until we have maturity. As Maharaj telling, in the mature stage of Ruchi then it is no longer necessary.
Also, it's stated earlier that even though we discuss consecutive stages, it doesn't really work like that. It's just that because we're conditioned souls and we can't understand the real thing, we're given placeholders. Just like Madhu Maharaj and I were discussing yesterday from Srila Gurudev's old 1992 darshans. He was saying that the jiva, well, you know, he always says it, and Jagadharma says it, that we were in the heart of Karanadakshai Vishnu, and then we came out through the light from his forehead, and then we had a moment of choice, and then we went up or down. So then I asked, well, where were we before then, after our creation? Where were we before Karanadakshai Vishnu? So Gurudev said, we were never created, we're eternal. So I said, well, does that mean we were eternally within the heart of Karanadakshai Vishnu? So then Gurudev said, no, it's like you were in his heart, but not in his heart. This is just said because you're a conditioned soul. Actually, he's not in the heart of Karanadakshai Vishnu. But because you're conditioned, you can't understand the real thing, so these placeholders are given. So we really don't know what's what. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was giving a glorification of his Guru Maharaj, Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, and his Vyas Puja Day. And he said, until we get the mercy of Guru, we are seeing sights of blindness and hearing sounds of deafness. And what does it mean to get the mercy of Guru? Then we turn to Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Gurudev songs in our songbook, and we see that, when will I get your mercy, and I will see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes before my eyes, and I'll see the Panchatattva dancing, and I'll hear their Mridanga playing, and then I'll go to a corner of a tree and weep. Or when will your mercy come so that the phantasmagoria of material sound vibration and material diseases disappear, and the phantasmagoria of material existence does no longer enter my ears, and my hair stands up in ecstasy, and all those symptoms. So really, we really don't understand anything. We can talk about it anyway. We have to talk about it. Because Guruji said we're in the material world, we have to use mundane language. And in Jiva Dharma, Raghunath Das Babaji tells his disciple, Rajanath, that when he's asking questions, don't even talk about this with anybody. Just do bhajan, and then the real understanding of everything will come. Right now, it's just like, what is it? Sakachandra Nyaya, the logic of the moon on the branch. Oh, look, the moon is sitting there on the branch of the tree. The sun is sitting on the branch of the tree. Gurudev said, if actually the sun is sitting on the branch of the tree, in an instant the sun would be incinerated and would become ashes.
The tree.
So, huh?
The tree would be
incinerated. The tree, yes. Does that help with the answer that he gave about Ruchi?
Yeah.
Slightly off topic, but this morning, for instance, Shripad Tridandi Maharaj was explaining how soft Krishna is, so that when the boys are playing, if one boy's lunch is stolen and he's being joked around and he's unhappy, immediately Krishna comes to make him happy, because Krishna doesn't want any of his friends to actually be unhappy. So I was just thinking how the queens in Dwarka, they're very unhappy because they're seeing that Krishna, they can't serve him, they can't make him happy. He's always weeping all night, he's just weeping and calling out the names of his associates in Braj, whether the gopis or the gopas or even the cows. And so all the queens in Dwarka are feeling very unhappy that they can't actually serve him. And I'm thinking, but they don't have any choice. They can't change their relationship with Krishna. They can only be his queens. So it seems they're condemned to this existence of being unable to make Krishna happy, and therefore being very unhappy themselves. And I was thinking, how is it possible such personalities, their regular position is unhappy, and how can Krishna be so cruel?
To my understanding, things come and go, just like, I'm going to ask Maharaj to give the answer too, but I just want to say what comes to my mind is that sometimes Radharani's in Man, and then it goes down, there are different moods that change, and then she'll be talking to the bumblebee how mean Krishna is, and then the next minute she'll say, it's actually just my misfortune, and I shouldn't say such terrible things, and Krishna might feel bad that I've said the terrible things. So the moods change. So my understanding is like at one moment they're unhappy, and therefore they go to Rohini and say, what is it about the Prajabasis that makes Krishna love them so much? And then at another time, Satyabhan is envious that Krishna gave the flower to Rukmini. And then they have this whole pastime of going to Indra together. Do you want to add something?
Okay, thanks, sir. Okay.
Okay.
This is the nature of bhakti ras.
How much you have, you feel always there's some luck in there.
Always mixing of ingredients, different waves. Yeah. And the waves, they are highest in Braj, not so high in Dwarka, less high. And here there is material ocean. Yeah.
And at the same?
Yadaras.
Right. And at the same time, our Prabhupada said that although Krishna's always with all the 16,000 queens, each queen thinks that he's henpecked to her. So the moods always change.
And also Gurudev explains, every associate of Krishna thinks that they are in ideal best position. Even those who are in Vaikuntha, they cannot understand. They know Krishna's coward boy, but they have so much attachment to their
But Lakshmi Devi is performing austerities.
She cannot give up her husband.
Yes, but still she's hankering for something
else. Until now, no success.
Yes, can't yet.
And at the same time, because on that realm, the pastimes are ever fresh and new, and also there are unlimited pastimes. So on one side, you might see Lakshmi performing austerities and then failing. And on the other side, you'll see that Lakshmi goes to the home of Anasuya, because Anasuya has captured her husband. So, and on the other side, you'll see that Lakshmi goes to the palace of Bali Maharaj, because he's captured her husband, Vamadev. So there are so many pastimes that go on at the same time. And then you'll see that there's the pastime of Narada, who's very angry because Vishnu gave him a monkey face, so that was it Sita or Lakshmi?
Lakshmi
put the garland on Narayan instead of Narada. Narada found out that it's because Vishnu gave him a monkey face, and so he went very angry to where Lakshmi was massaging Lord Narayan, and then he cursed him that your wife will be taken away from you in your future birth, and you're going to have to take the shelter of monkeys. So, so many things are going on at the same time. And that their unhappiness and frustration is not like ours anyway. It's also full of ecstasies. Like when Radharani is envious of Chandravali, like Krishna says to Radharani, "O Chandra," as though he had made a mistake and thought of Radharani as Chandravali. "Oh, Chandra? Well, you can go right back to her. I'm not having any relationship with you anymore." So even her enviousness is, and that unhappiness is so happy. So it's, again, it's inconceivable to our conditioned state.
Yeah, so everything is happiness.
Everything is happiness.
Separation, ananda, increasing.
Here everything going in, and there everything evaporation increasing.
Gaur Premanandi, Shrila Bhakti Vinod Thakur Ki Jai, Shri Bhajan Ramasi Ki Jai, Shrila Gurudev Ki Jai, Shrila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Assembled Devotees Ki Jai. If anybody needs a wheel of fortune, why don't you go to your beautiful Dukasimha Devotees.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama.